Ba-da-ba-ba.
Ba-da-ba-ba.
All right. Promoter 101. This is Jason Flom, chairman and CEO and founder of Lava Records, and you're listening to me now live on Promoter 101.
Welcome, everyone, to the 66th edition of Promoter 101. I'm Dan Steinberg and joined, as always, by my friend, Luke Pierce. Welcome, Luke.
Thank you very much. Of course, I'm very, very excited about this episode. We're recording this week's podcast from the Intercontinental Hotel in New Orleans as a part of Eventbrite and Ticketfly's FlyCon 2018. Very happy to be in the Big Easy.
In just a few moments, we'll take you live to our session from FlyCon with our special guest from Daigle Ventures, founder, Brooklyn Bowls, Lock-In, Relics, and the man that put Fare Thee Well together, the 50th anniversary of the Grateful Dead reunion, Mr. Peter Shapiro.
Natalia, United Talent Agency, and I'm on Promoter 101.
We get to break some amazing news right now. We're excited to announce that Promoter 101's very own Mr. Dan Steinberg is going to be interviewing Live Nation CEO Michael Rapino during the keynote at the Polestar Touring Conference Wednesday, February 7th in Los Angeles at the Intercontinental Hotel downtown LA. Dan, you got to be pumped for this.
Very honored to be tapped for this, Luke. What a great, great honor. They've only given me one rule when it comes to interviewing the biggest promoter in the world, and that's honestly all they said to me is, don't go easy. They've got no shackles on me. Well done, Mr. Rapino. Game on. Looking forward to seeing you in LA on February 7th.
Fantastic. Well, listen, registration for Polestar Live is still open. You can come see Dan sit down with Live Nation CEO Michael Rapino on Wednesday, February 7th by registering today at polestar.live. Come check it out.
But that's not the only thing we got going on for the next couple months. Listeners across the pond, get ready because we'll be at the Royal Garden Hotel in Kensington, London for the International Music Conference. That's right, ILMC, March 6th through 9th, 2018.
ILMC is an absolutely phenomenal conference. It's the best of the best of agents, promoters, managers, and marketers from outside the U.S. And this is the 30th year, and you can come join us as well. Register before February 6th to take advantage of some early bird rates at 30.ilmc.com.
It's going to be a good time there. I'm on an amazing panel that's basically storytelling and shit talking. It's the last panel of the entire conference. And there's something going on with Promoter 101, IQ Magazine, and ILMC that's going to be announced very shortly. We're really excited about this, and I can't wait to break the news.
This is Ray Waddell. You need to be in the room at Polestar Live 2018 when Dan Steinberg interviews Michael Rapino from Live Nation.
Our reissue for the week is a great episode of Promoter 101. If you've missed any of our past episodes, you can always catch up at promoter101.net. This week, episode 23, we sit down with solo agencies, John Giddings, as well as Gersh Agencies, reigning king of comedy, the agent to Dave Chappelle, Rick Greenstein. If you haven't heard it, it's new to you.
Dan and I want to hear from you. If you've got feedback, send us an email to stani at promoter101.net. You're going to reach both of us on that email. And of course, you can tweet at us. Tag us in your Instagram stories. I'm at WLukePierce on both Twitter and Instagram. And Dan is at The Jew on Twitter and at Dan Presents on Instagram. And this podcast is Promoters. That's Promoters plural. 101 on both Twitter and Instagram.
Please take the moment just to subscribe to Promoter 101. It's free. The stories, the interviews every week, it's all at your fingertips. All you have to do to subscribe is anywhere you podcast, literally, it just takes seconds. Just hit that button and drop us a review if you get a chance to, because, you know, that never hurts.
This is Dan Smalls from DSP Shows, and you're on Promoter 101.
Dan, kicking off the news of the week here, we've got to talk first about something we've talked about many, many times in the past here, which is seemingly the resolution of the Ticketmaster and Songkick lawsuit, which was settled a few weeks back with a $110 million payment from Ticketmaster to Complete Entertainment Resources Group, that's the holding company for CrowdSearch and Songkick, to settle out this disputed claims that we're going to be headed to court later this month. This marks pretty much the end of one chapter of Songkick, of CrowdSearch, and a resolution with Live Nation, although I think there are many other things that can come from this conversation. I know that some of the things that were going to be presented in a courtroom have not yet been resolved, and I think some of those things could find their own criminal hearings. So it's not the last that we've heard of Songkick, but it's the last we've heard of the Songkick and Ticketmaster side of things. And it ends with Live Nation and Ticketmaster writing a $110 million check to the owners and investors of Songkick.
Couple things. First of all, this came out Friday afternoon. I was heading to the airport for APAP, and I saw this come out on the feeds. I think Dave Brooks broke it. $110 million. The question you got to ask yourself is, how big of a deal is that to a company Live Nation size? I mean, clearly, that's not 50 bucks. They're going to notice that in their year end. But then again, they're a multi-million dollar company. Was that an insurance bet that we're like, better to pay 110 than get a judgment that could be ridiculous? On the other side, does $110 million save Songkick? Or are they just so far into bankruptcy, it just isn't going to matter?
This company's shut down and done. They were with basically a bare-bones staff of Matt Jones, the CEO, and a handful of lawyers and folks to resolve the outstanding customer service issues they had with dates that have yet to play, but this is the end of the end for them. Between the $110 million settlement, the $5 million sale of the Songkick assets to Warner Music Group, you're seeing about $115 million put back into a company that has raised millions and millions and millions of dollars, and the effective end of this company. Now, the question I ask myself about this is, certainly there must have been something that raised this price tag to $110 million. And I think the relative value of $110 million to Songkick going to court could have looked like, which really could have challenged the existence of exclusive rights to exclusive ticketing in North America. You got to remember that Songkick comes from the UK, where exclusive ticketing is not a thing. They weren't challenged with the same programs and exclusive ticket contracts that we deal with between Ticketmaster and venues here, and that's why they had such a hard time really breaking into the US marketplaces, dealing with some of the Ticketmaster fan club policies and the rights that the Ticketmasters paid for to sell those tickets. By going to court, they could have possibly challenged that as a seemingly interesting piece of antitrust case law. So by saying that Ticketmaster may not have the right to these exclusive agreements in the U.S. under some sort of case law, that could have been threatening and incredibly damaging to the long-term existence of Ticketmaster as a business. So in the end of the day, is $110 million worth it to stave off the billions of dollars of revenue that you're going to generate from allowing exclusive ticketing to exist in America? I don't know. And I don't know if that's where this was going with things, but my sense about the entire thing from our conversations with people that know more than us about this is that this was just about as much as a returning dollar amount value back to the shareholders and investors of Songkick as it was about challenging the legacy of Ticketmaster in North America. So we'll have to see what shakes out after this. I don't think we're done hearing about this yet.
I would love to find out in the grand scheme of things, when you cut $110 million, what else is going on in your head? Big things on the move. Hey, let's talk about the dead company have announced they're going to be out May through July this summer. They're hitting the East Coast mainly. The big question is the bands with Scott Clayton. I'm wondering if the paper got issued by CAA or WME based on where he was at that moment. But either way, you know, Scott booked those dates.
Absolutely. And it's great to see that the Dead & Company continues to roll on through. So important to have kind of that legacy continue through things, and really glad the business is there.
I'm just excited the guys from the Grateful Dead were able to learn all those John Mayer songs. That's incredible. I'm going to hell for that joke.
Yeah, you really are.
Conference season, and joining us right now is the legendary music journalist Ray Waddell from Polestar Magazine, here to preview the conference for us. Ray, how you doing?
I'm great. How are you doing? Great to be here.
What are you excited about? What can you tell us?
It's coming together great. We announced Garth Brooks, just a phenomenal tour, and over 6 million tickets sold.
Leads me to ask, how many keynotes could you guys possibly roll? He's famous for adding show after show after show. Will Garth do 3 or 4 keynotes in a row for you during the conference to make sure everybody gets to hear him?
I think he's got quite a few things planned. Now, seriously, he may do a bar mitzvah while he's in L.A., and we're real honored to have him. The guy's got a real take. He doesn't do a lot of these sorts of things, and he's deeply engaged in the business aspect. He'll be up there with Jared Smith from Ticketmaster. We expect it to be a lot of fun.
Yeah, I'm excited to hear what he has to say. And there's certainly some amazing names listed as well that scattered through some of the other panels. Guys like Scott Leslie and Joe Attanian, who are bringing agent versus promoter to the live format for the first time. You've got the young, you've got the old, you've got the hip, you've got the major, all come together at one major conference. It's just a whole lot of everything at one time. There's a little something in there for everybody.
Dude, you ought to be a promoter.
If only it was allowed. I'm excited to see Jay Williams, Jenna Adler, Dave Shapiro, and Bob Rue. Rue and Jay Williams, it just feels like you ought to open up a bottle of Jack Daniels and see what happens.
We just added Greg Perloff to that panel as well.
The names go for days. You got the big keynote. I'm excited about the promoter and me. Just can't wait to hear what the biggest promoter in the world's going to say.
Well, we're real excited about that too, Dad, and to have you on board. And I think it's a really interesting dynamic to have an independent and a visionary one like yourself who has found a way to not only survive but thrive in this current environment. And really the CEO of the largest concert company that's ever existed in the history of Earth, right? And, you know, I think it's worth noting that was his choice. That was Michael Rapino's choice for Dan to come do the interview. I think it says a lot about him, and I'm stoked about it. I can't wait to see it.
Thrilled to be on the same dad's card. Can't wait to ask him to break down his playbook for me, and just excited that he's going to have to sit there and answer my questions.
Oh, yeah, he's stoked about it, too.
Well, it's February 6, 7, and 8, coming to Polestar Live, Production Live, Polestar Live. It's all on sale right now, and it always sells out, so you got to get in there in advance.
It's going to be fun too. So I would highly recommend you guys coming in for that.
February 6 to 8, you can get your tickets at Polestar.live. They're on sale now. It's always the biggest conference of the year. Don't miss it. Thank you, Ray Waddell, for being with us.
Hey, I appreciate you, Dan, and I appreciate what you do. I think this is a great thing, and I look forward to seeing you here in a couple of weeks, bud.
And wrapping up the news of the week here on this short week for us here, Forecastle, that's the Live Nation-owned festival in Louisville, Kentucky, announced some of its headliners this week, continuing kind of a trend here. We're seeing Chris Stapleton, Arcade Fire, and Modest Mouse all headlining the, I think this is the third or fourth year for Forecastle now. It's grown into something certainly regionally that's become significant to folks in Nashville, Indianapolis, St. Louis as a destination event that's not quite the size of Bonnaroo, but still a really well-run event. Really looking forward to attending this one.
Hi, David Simone from DSW Entertainment on Promoter 101.
And it's that time we want to take a moment to shine a spotlight on IMP's Seth Hurwitz. He's an independent promoter working with acts from the club levels to the arena, known for cutting his own path. No matter what anybody else thinks, got the coolest club in the country, the 930 in DC, making him this week's Promoter 101 Badass of the Week.
Hello, it's John Valentino with AEG Presents, and here we are on Promoter 101.
Well, we're excited to be in the Big Easy. This is the first time we've ever recorded in New Orleans. It's Promoter 101, and we're live, guys. This is going to be a good time. Welcome.
We have an amazing featured guest today.
That's right, Luke. We've got a guy who has been part of the music industry discussion for the last 20 years. When he was 23 years old, guy owned the Wetlands in New York, one of the most successful clubs in the country. 20 years later, when it came to putting the Grateful Dead back together, there was only one guy they'd call for that. Ladies and gentlemen, from Lock-In, from Relics Magazine, from the Brooklyn Bowl, the people they call Shappy, Flycon, please put your motherfucking hands together for Mr. Peter Shapiro!
Welcome to the podcast.
How about that for an intro?
He's getting warmed up. I'm expecting, hopefully that's just the beginning of high hopes for Steiny.
Absolutely. We're particularly happy to have you here in New Orleans, and it's great to be in front of everyone here at Eventbrite and Ticketfly, because you've got quite this special connection to Ticketfly, right? There's some connection between your businesses?
Yeah, I guess I was the first person to sign up when it was one of those things that is an idea.
Does that make you client zero?
It makes, yeah, I hope I get like some socks for that or something. but I saw, you know, it matters, like your relationship with people. And when you have the opportunity to have a relationship with your ticketing company, like I had with Andrew, you know, there's a lot of trust involved. It's a really important relationship. And everything you do, that we do, all of us putting on shows, it helps a lot when you have that relationship. So he told me he had this idea, and I was like, I'm in. And there was no venue, there was no ticketing company. So I guess he believed also. But he didn't have to do the signing bonus because there's no venue.
So. So speaking of relationships, we had a moment to talk to some of the people that do know you best. And this is what they say about you. Madison House Presents' Don Sullivan says, Peter is passionate about working, making sure everything he touches makes both the experience for the artist and the fan truly epic. Bowery.
I owe him a beer. There's one beer down.
Bowery's Jomo, John Moore, said, he's all about the music personally. He's all about the fans professionally. Is there any better pairing under one brain? That's why he does, and we all do, what we do.
Paradigm's Joshua Knight. Pete is the type of guy that no matter if it's 9 a.m. on a Sunday or 2 a.m. on a Tuesday, he's there ready to talk about how we can take over the world one show at a time.
The world needs rock and roll. Yeah,
absolutely. And Phil Lesh in Forbes, he said, working exclusively with Pete allows me to focus on the thing that I enjoy most, putting together bands that bring vastly different perspectives to our traditional repertory. So it's to transform old songs into something new, rich, and strange. These are the songs that are like fairy tales. All versions are true. With Pete, I feel like I have the freedom to explore as many of those versions as I can. That's a pretty lofty praise.
Some high praise from a lot of fucking powerful people, man. How does that make you feel?
I try not to think about stuff too much sometimes because it'll throw you off. So it feels great, but I just try not to do it and not sit there and be like, holy shit, that's Phil Lesh. I grew up loving that dude, you know, because I got to see him in a week and I don't want to just, and I know what we want to be here talking just like he's my, like he's Steiny, just talking normal, you know, and we'll talk later. Like there's other times when you're down here and you try, you can't go too up here. It helps you later when you're fucked on something and then you like, okay, stay in the middle.
Try to keep balanced. So,
yeah, absolutely.
But I'll think about Phil later, you know, late night.
Where are you going with that, man?
I'm just kidding around. I was trying. Come on. We're live in New Orleans.
Absolutely.
That was pretty good. Got
it. Welcome to FlyCon, everybody.
Right.
In Dan's intro, you know, he rattled off a ton of successes and a ton of accomplishments at, you know, the age of 44. That's an incredible amount, but first glance look like success really comes easy to you, but that's definitely not the case, right? There were some early years and some lessons you learned starting out so early at 23 in New York owning Wetlands, lessons you had to learn and things you had to carry throughout the business. Right. So where were those early years at for you?
I mean, I'm big on experience, like the whole Malcolm Gladwell 10,000 hours thing, which is to be really great at something, you have to do it a lot. You have to have done it a lot. I feel lucky that I got started so early. You know, in now I'm in mid-range, kind of maybe age-wise, but I've done a show every night, you know, in New York for 20 years. And that creates a lot of perspective and experience. So, like, I can stay back to there, staying here, like, not going up to down, like, when shit, because a lot of what we do is dealing with things that go wrong. When it's easy, you know, you don't have to be on the phone at 2 a.m, you know, unless it's a really good idea. But when things go wrong, you know, it's how you respond to that that is what happens in the end. That's really important in shows and, like, things go wrong at shows and, like, you know, fixing them quickly and, like, easily so that the people at the show or at any event, like, they don't even notice. Because shit's always going wrong, but people don't always notice if you're good at, you know, so... I don't know if that's an answer to your question, but yeah. There you go.
No, mistakes.
But I learned that at Wetlands, sorry. You know, a lot there was going wrong. It was
right?
A 90. A lot harder. We did now these, you know, people, kids here, there's some people who remember pre-internet, like, it's a different world and promoting shows, so you press some buttons. I mean, it's still hard, but, like, you can do a last-minute show now and just send an email out. Back when I started and it was at Wetlands, it was pre-internet. If you got a huge last-minute underplay, like, you couldn't do it in a day because you'd have to make flyers and get the radio station to do stuff. We had to get the ad. I saw Michael Swears here. He remembers. And Jack Walsh, you had to get your ad into the Village Voice on a certain deadline. And back then, with print, it was, like, 96, you know, a bunch of days in advance.
Yeah, but you had to get the ad in Monday for Wednesday Street.
Yeah, something, you definitely had to get it in. And you had to flyer. That's a great art. I mean, it's still around a little bit.
Yeah, I don't fucking miss doing that.
Right. Stuff that Ticketfly is doing is actually, you know, Ticketfly screwed the flyer guys.
That's the quote from the conference.
Putting sandwich board guys out of business forever.
Could have been a good name for this event.
Ticketfly killed the flyer guy.
Let's talk about, you were 23 years old and you wound up owning the Wetlands in New York. I mean, the legendary club. How did it fucking wind up in your hands at 23 years old?
Because of Larry Block. There was a guy, a special guy, who he started Wetlands. He was like a deadhead. And it's funny, if anyone here knows Manhattan, it's in Tribeca. He picked the spa in Manhattan where he thought no one would ever want to live, so Wetlands could live there forever, because you always know that's an issue, rock clubs and people living places nearby. So he picked this spot at the exit of the Holland Tunnel. And I was seeing maybe if it was Larry Block. He passed away, unfortunately, but I had a feeling, knowing Larry, that he might have called me. He could pull stuff. That's what it's about, magic. Larry had that. But he picked the exit of the Holland Tunnel. But unfortunately, that became Tribeca, and he had a lease, and it was like 5-6 years left on the lease, and everyone there knew you weren't going to get a 20-year extension, 15-year extension. This building would get sold and made into lofts, condos. He literally, it's on the exit of the Holland Tunnel, the first corner, and he's like, no one will ever want to live here. And now it's like $10, $20, $15 million. It's crazy stuff. So the bigger companies like John Scher and Delsner, they weren't going to take a venue. Only had 5-6 years left. And maybe me today, I wouldn't want to do it as much, because to invest so much of yourself in something that's going to end. And it couldn't. That's what happened. It's fancy apartments. Mike Piazza lives up there and John Stewart. But we're going to protest later outside. But it gave me the opportunity to get Wetlands. If it had been a long lease, He gave it to me by committing. We ran an environmental center. It was pre-internet. So before the internet, if you were like Amnesty International, Rainforest Action Network, and you wanted to have a meeting, you couldn't just press send to your email list. So you wanted to have a meeting. So do you have young people meet me? That's who usually goes to things like this, at the library, at the hotel ballroom. You know, where do you go? School, church? No. Rock club? You know, yes. And that's what happened. People would go for meetings there before the show in the basement lounge. And I agreed to continue to do the meeting, you know, fund that and enable that and hire someone to run that. And he then made it possible. I paid him every month, but he gave it to me, basically. That's how you get a rock club at 23, I guess. Yeah.
And the Wetlands, you turned that success around and jumped into Brooklyn Bowl. And there were plenty of lessons along the way that you took from the Wetlands to Brooklyn Bowl in New York that applied through time, and attention to detail and the fan experience that's carried throughout.
Yeah, actually.
You always talk about that as being a pinnacle of your success.
It's like now you build the venues perfect or as good as you can. We are trying now, but Wetlands, you took over something that pre-existed, and it was not a great place traditionally to watch a concert. The fans couldn't really see the stage. But so that made the venue have to work harder to make it still be awesome. And it was, but it was in a unique angle. You wouldn't build a new venue that way, but it was magical because, like, you couldn't always see the show. So you'd end up at the, you know, bar or in the basement lounge. You could hear the show, but you'd hang out with your friends. And like I say the story, like I always meet people who are like, yo, bro, I met my wife at Wetlands, you know, in the lounge. At the bar, between set, we also made all the bands do two sets for interact, and like people interacted more. You know, most venues now built now, and even our, you know, and that's a little bit about how Brooklyn Bowl came about. Different areas of the village, you know, a lot of great venues are really just though a stage facing a bar and a perfect GA. You just watch the show; it's awesome, but you don't meet your next wife probably there at the show. And so Wetlands led to you maneuvering around and hanging out in different areas. So it was a cool way to, it was challenging, but you learn how to, if you could make it good there, then when you got a cool, you could start scratch, add some of that with some better sight lines, maybe with a little food, maybe with some visual, maybe a bowling lane or two. And then that's kind of how it all one went to the other, you know.
Now, your success with the Brooklyn Bowl was so amazing that you guys wound up opening two additional bowls, Vegas and London. London's another one of those stories where you tried something that was completely out of your element, international business, opening a club that was hot in Brooklyn, but would it work in another country? And then you went and put it on the biggest tourist strip in the world. And you didn't really close on top of each other, really right. Scaled up. Like, one of them is
not
still
planned
around.
That way, but that's an example. Like, we didn't want them to open at the same time. Something, you know, everyone here knows you can't control, you know, how many tickets someone buys for a concert always.
Well, same thing. And they're both rough starts, right? Yeah. But can you talk about London wasn't exactly what that was originally supposed to be for you and never really turned into that and went away? And then Vegas started a little rough, but has now become very successful. Can you talk about that project and how that was worked out?
They're both not what we were planning, in that never expected. after Brooklyn Bowl opened it, if we did another, it would end up in Las Vegas. It's giant. It's 80,000 square feet. It's in the center of the strip, but it was just a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity. It came to build a venue in the center of the strip, in an atmosphere everyone's doing EDM stuff. The clubs there, you know, are Hakkasan and Omnia and Lavo and Tao. They're just very different than what Wetlands and Brooklyn Bowl and that kind of vibe, and I just felt there was room for one of those. So I put it all on the line, and then in London was similar. An opportunity came to do one at the O2 Arena. You know, there are no new venues in London because you can't, there's no new build, there's nothing, there's no real estate, and the city councils, called the councils there, you can't get any new venues. So all the venues you guys hear about, Brixton Academy and a Roundhouse, I mean, they're all old. So the opportunity to get a new venue, we went further out than we would have other, like, out, you did something we wouldn't have. But they told us 24-hour train would be there, and it ended up not being there. They told us they'd do a whole thing around it. That's another example. You don't always.
This is on the west end of London, right? Like,
yeah,
past,
or southeast.
Southeast? Okay.
Yeah. So it just wasn't perfect. I'm looking, it started to work. We did it for 3 years. It's a great man here, Jake Snofrowski, who booked the Wetlands and booked Brooklyn Bowl in London, did a fucking awesome job.
Where's Jake yet?
He's here. But they started construction after 3 years again to do what they told us they'd do, to build a whole village around us. They told us that would be there, and then when we got there, we were at the end, and they didn't finish the village. We weren't in the middle. We were at the end. So we decided to pause there. It wasn't perfect, and we'll go back at the right time. But Vegas, we feel really proud. We just, you know, it came really close. It's hard to launch a new venue without being an office in that town for 10 years, Live Nation AG, with the email list and the baked-in infrastructure. So going and doing a new thing, it's really hard. And I'm really, really proud that Brooklyn Bowl was named, they have one, when I got there, I got some advice from the guy who runs marketing at Caesars. He's like, in Vegas, you want to win Las Vegas Weekly Reader's Choice Awards. Every steakhouse, strip house, strip club, strip house, you know, everything, casino, musical Cirque show wants Reader's Choice, best, and you use that for your advertising. There's a lot of competition. Vegas is up here. You know, it's 100 shows a night, and they're all here, pretty much. And for that, we won it 2 years in a row, best venue in Vegas, Brooklyn Bowl. So that's hard. And
give it up.
It's hard. You almost, you know, we can talk. I don't know if you want to go further there, but it is.
Well, I want you to go all the way, Pete.
Yeah, it's not easy when you start at zero, you know, in a new venue.
Well, and you had to retrain the market, right? Because they weren't used to multiple nights of Umphrey's McGee or Avett Brothers. Like the idea of coming out,
we brought our scene there,
and then coming out, or shows that played for more than an hour.
I got a good one. I opened. I wanted to see if late night jazz fest. And we're in New Orleans. I want to see if late night New Orleans could work in Vegas. I felt at midnight every night, if Galactic was playing in a cool spot with vibe on the center of the strip in Vegas, maybe I was hoping too much, and it was before our current president, so it was a better day. And I was hoping that New Orleans would work. And here's how you have to try. One night, that's not really going to tell you. So we're like, we're going to do fucking 10 nights of Galactic. Our first month. Open midnight, because then you can promote around. It's 10 nights. Galactic, late night, New Orleans. And it wasn't there, you know, at first. But I had no email list. I'd like to try it again, but we've built it. And it was hard because night one, you have no email list. You have no Facebook. You have no socials. I remember the opening night. It was like one of the best nights of my life. Talk about going here and here. I had it in like 1 hour, one of the best moments of my life and one of the worst, which is for opening night in Vegas. We had to raise the money. We own the venue, but we have a landlord, Caesars, but we wanted them. We were hopeful they'd do a lot of things, and God bless them, they did some things. But the one thing they did do is opening night, I was like, I want to get the Roots, who are like the house band from Wetlands. We did the Roots every night on a Sunday night for a year in 1998. And Questlove's played Brooklyn Bowl more 300 times. He's done a DJ gig every Thursday for you. So they're home team. I was like, I want to open it for, with the Roots. It's a Friday. They'll do it. I got to pick them up from the Tonight Show. You got to give me a plane. You know, I can't afford, you know, it's not, I'll pay them. You give me, I need the plane, and I'll try to get Fallon to cop on or something. We'll just get, you know, we'll just do. And they gave me the plane. of course, Jimmy didn't get on the plane, but I got him to do a tweet. This is where I learned. So, and I remember this, the guy from Caesars was like, that works. Okay, thank you. You know, I needed something for the plane. We got on the plane after the Tonight Show. We flew to Vegas. We landed like 11:30 midnight. You can imagine the plane with the routes private to Vegas to land open. There was, I remember, I once went to meet Warren Haynes in Kansas and went on a bus. It was not a plane, but it was a bus, but similar environment, if you know. And I sat down. I flew to Kansas to meet with him. And the bus was so smoky, let's say, that we sat down and I forgot what the meeting was going to be about, that I came to Kansas.
How did that happen?
So
Peter?
Vegas is like that. We're on the plane. We land. I forget what venue. We're going to our venue. It's opening night. Sold out. It's awesome. Well, from the airport to the venue. I get in. It's fucking packed. The routes are jamming. I'm like, this is it. Came to Vegas, like fast forward 10 minutes, and I'm in a lounge. I have an old friend who owns this club out there, DJ Tao, big one, and Marquee, and Lava, Jason Strauss, who has Marquee in New York. You mean?
Yeah, the EDM stuff.
So he's like, yo, bro, come here. I know him since I'm in high school. Forever. He's from New York. He's like, come here. I'm like, yo, yeah, cool. He's like, I just want to chat with you for a sec. He's like, you don't even know how fucked you are. I love you, and I'm saying that because I love you. You don't even know, because I was like, isn't this great? And he's like, you're fucked, because no one does a venue in Vegas that's not in a casino. No one like goes and owns it. You raising money, you just get a casino to fund it, and you do a management deal. You don't really own it. And no one does live music. You do DJ, like Bottle Street, like those three. No, and we ended up doing all three. And he's like,
you're a schmuck.
Yeah. And he's like, the only reason it might work, he said, if you were from Vegas, you never would have done it. If you knew, and we had researched, he was just like, never. And you know what? Knowing what I know and how hard and how close we came to not, you know, I get where he's coming from there. That's why there was no 2000 cap live music venue, really. It's in a straight, you know, not in a casino.
So ignorance was bliss in the end, because it wouldn't have happened otherwise, had you known.
Maybe. But and we came close, but we did it. But there are certain things. Those are opportunities, relics. When I took it over, everyone's like, you're an idiot. Wetlands, I was 23. What are you doing? You don't know what you... And you have to judge sometimes when to listen, and also sometimes to be stubborn, and there's opportunity in danger also, you know.
Go back
to
that for a second.
Rock and roll,
you know? You were talking about sometimes it was really close to not working, and I think I heard the number 48 hours, give or take. Maybe that may have fell off the track at one point. Vegas may not be here, but it got saved?
It came close, but...
How'd you get saved?
It's being recorded, so we'll tell the story, because he doesn't know. We've never told him. There's a company out there, if the guy's listening, called NetApp. And like a couple years ago, he had a party, and we were facing difficult times. And we were just a couple days away from a real difficult moment and a hard deadline where we need, you know. And his party came in, and he was having it the next week, and he called, I think, himself, the head of the company. And he's like, we're not 600 people, we're 1,200. We're not doing well, we're doing top shelf. We're adding to it, you know. So the party, the amount of money went from here to here. And it was the next week, so I told the guy who's running Brooklyn Bowl, tell him the party's next week, so we need the money tomorrow. I need it by Thursday, it was Tuesday. It was a payroll. If we didn't make it, and he called the guy, and the guy FedEx a check the next day, and we made payroll. And that's the truth.
Wow.
And then it just went. 40. You know, then you build a part, you know, then we got another thing and then another thing. But it takes a minute. And we almost didn't get there.
So if not for that dude.
Well, it's a long story, but it's not as simple as like, I mean, I've done shit at Wetlands where you ever take your own credit card and buy a lot of drinks at your own bar because you can get the money faster than you have to pay it. That's a good trick for FlyCon if anyone wants to open a bar. A
lot of club owners in the room. Anybody know that feeling?
I've done that one. You know, that's
a lot of people
close.
Smiling right now.
Because the credit card company sends the money in a couple days, and then you get the bill like a month later. So like it got that close. But that was a well
3% big on it. But
Vegas would have been a lot more. I don't know if I would have had the credit limit. But it wasn't like we could just put money in or call my parent, I need help. We were beyond. We were like, anyways.
It seems
like
you're
supposed to tell that story, but it's okay.
That's a good story. And it seems like you're like a glutton for punishment with like half of all these challenges. And you
I'm
touched
in a good
on
place now.
Yeah.
I mean, luckily, and this is what I talked about. It's you get you can get to a better, you know, it's not perfect, but you get to a better place.
Yeah,
we're good, and it gets easier. It does get easy when you're
struggling. You're among friends, man. You're in New Orleans. You're in a
better
place.
It's hard when you're struggling. When it's hard, it's hard.
Yeah.
When it's easy, it's easy. You know, when it's hard, it could be hard. Hard selling, you know. There's times when it's just hard, but that's what's ironic about the business. I think most people here are probably not Live Nation or AEG people because they got their own ticket. They're not going to be at FlyCon. That's why it's easier for them when they have 100 venues or 50 venues. They, you know, there's a lot of benefits to scale. That's what's the tough thing about business. It's hard when you're little. Much harder.
You touched on something for a second there in Relics, which is a magazine. Like, you're doubling down on the media business. You know, you're running after it in a game where publishers are slashing left and right, and you're doubling down your time and effort in that space. How did that really come into your life?
You know, unique situation like Wetlands. Wasn't really looking at do a rock club, but Wetlands is such a unique opportunity. Relics wasn't looking to own a music magazine in 2009, but there's only one Relics. There's only one Wetlands. I believe a lot, and especially in this crowded, crazy world, brands, or I hate the word brand, not credibility. It's like these things, though, like Capitol Theater. I own is an old, great, you know, to be as known and something that's been around, I actually think is a great opportunity. Look at Seth's, his venue, you know, 930 being an institution. And Relics is an institution. It had a space that, oh, you know, they'll never, it's got 43 years, so it's hard to do that new. If we could then integrate some new stuff into it, and things can be reinvented.
You certainly brought Cool back to it because it was a dying entity, and you guys have not only brought Love back into it, but it's the source for that community across the whole country and internationally as well. That's, you guys really made the pace with that.
Yeah, it's cool. It's cool to see how the community and the scene, where it's at. It didn't used to be cool for indie rock bands to be into the Grateful Dead. And now it is, I think. Look at the national. I mean, I don't know how I got from there to there, but you got now Relics, well, it grew up. I don't know if people all here know, is like a Grateful Dead magazine for its first like 20, 25 years. And now, like, the recent covers and artists who want to be on it are like Beck, Stapleton, Ryan Adams, still a touch, the national guys. We still do the Dead stuff a lot. And they, 10 years ago, Beck wouldn't want to be on the cover of Relics. Yeah, you're right, you know? But now I think the scene, the live scene, what Bonnaroo did, and Bonnaroo is different now than it was. What Bonnaroo was, and I don't mean, still like Bonnaroo.
The jam bandy, not
still like
Super
Bonnaroo, but what, yeah, now with Locke and what I've got.
Well, and let's talk about
Dead,
that. Relics,
I guess Dead 50.
Did you Relics know. Lead to that? Then you, since you had that brand of the magazine, did that lead to the start of Locke in?
I think of now, I feel like I'm on a psychiatrist couch. Did that lead to Locke in? I'm not sure. No, I was.
I mean, because
yeah, how did Locke? Yeah, you know, it led to Locke in going to a lot of festivals, and they're awesome, but there's 8 stages, and you're at Bonnaroo, and you're like, should we go see Wilco over there? The Flaming Lips are here, Chromeo's over here, and Beck's over there. What should we do? And we'll be like, let's go back on the bus and hang out. Like, overwhelming. You know, that happened a lot in the years at Bonnaroo. And so the Locke in idea was one stage. And the music would never stop. Or 2 stages at first. Now we're one with the table. So you could just be here and still have that experience and not have to move around. It was locked together. That's really, and more core to our, you know, Bonnaroo was starting to move away from just being about that scene and felt there was room for, and it was just the land. We go back, someone, my Dave Fry called me and was like, you got to come see this land. And it was really
This is Virginia, right?
Yeah, it's 30 miles outside Charlottesville, right at the edge of the Blue Ridge Mountain Range, and it's sick land. And as I was fortunate, I love Bonnaroo, like the first 10 years of it, but to be in Blue Ridge Hills, and look, there's an issue now, I think, festivals that have come out and just been on parking lots, that's hard, and it worked for a little while. I went to Woodstock 99 with Jake, who's here. We knew, we left. We knew shit was going to go down because of the crustaceans.
Shit was getting real, man. Shit
knows what that means. Well, we had a moment in the middle of the night, but we'll talk about that later. Well, we knew because it was on, it was really hot. You were on an Air Force hangar runway. water, like just it was, you know, it was hot and you were on asphalt. And Korn, Limp Bizkit, Metallica, and all that were playing. And it was a camping festival. Like, that mix was just, we knew, we left. We were like, this shit's going to get weird. But it did. And we thought, it wasn't that hard. It's not like we're genius. It's just if you were at there, it was 103, you're on asphalt. It's going to be 4 days. It's Friday afternoon. And coming up is Limp Bizkit, Korn, and Metallica. You'd be like, we should get out of here. it's going to be fires.
We got some questions from social media. A lot of people wrote in, but we took a couple of our favorite, if you wouldn't mind humoring us. So via email was sent in by Carter Spadel. What's your piece of advice for a college graduate looking to get into the promotion side of the business?
I would just go start doing it if you can, even on a very small level. If you're in a college town, find someone to do it with. Anything I've done, we've done with people, like great partners in different ways or keep people running a venue. I don't know if we're going to talk about partner with someone if you can and then go do it. Even if you're small scale, doesn't matter because all the shit that goes wrong at a show for 200 people. A lot of it's the same 200 to that 2,000, which is why the 200 one's harder because you can't make enough money to hire the people. The 2,000 fucking one, that's easy when you get there. Easier. You got people, you know, you can make
money coming in.
Yeah.
It makes a way
It's
easier.
Ironic the world. It kind of sucks that the small guy, it's harder for him. It is. It's a lot harder, I think, when you're alone. But that's a great time to do it. You know, try it.
Yeah. We got this one from Schneck the What on Instagram. He said, what is the first thing you do in the morning, and what is the last thing you do at night?
Probably the first thing I'll do when I walk off stage to the. But by the way, it's Roxy Shapiro. Look at my daughter. I wasn't going to look at my phone. I was just, look at my daughter.
That name's...
Roxy Shapiro, I named my daughter, so like if things don't go well, I'm like, people will book you no matter what, and you'll get $1,000 minimum to start. Roxy Shapiro and doing reggae, I thought. I'm like, I booked that. That's what I'm saying.
What was the last thing? First thing in the last, well, fuck it, let's
just,
move on.
Yeah, that was a good answer. Fuck it. That's what I do in the beginning of the day and the end of the day.
You know, there's a million things I want to talk to you about, but... Let's do a speed round and then let's get to the dead. Either or, you just can't say both. Easy enough. Vinyl or MP3s?
Streaming. I broke the rule on the first
it's
one.
Okay.
Next.
How about New York or Vegas?
I want to answer that. Or just the digital listening to music. For someone who like gets time just in the shower, I look forward to the day where I'm less busy and can sit back, have a listening room and go vinyl. That's eventually. Right now, just having the phone and playing fucking some playlists, being in the shower with the Bluetooth grain audio, like that works really good for me. Sorry.
How about New York or Vegas?
New York.
William Morris.
But I'm going to Vegas tomorrow.
William Morris or CAA?
CAE.
Ticketmaster or Ticketfly?
Fly.
There you go. That's
Fly.
Right.
I mean, Andrew Dreskin, I don't know if he's still here. And we're going to catch him because I don't think he was Andrew. You're gonna hear, what the fuck? Andrew?
I think he knew what the answer was going to be. That was safe.
And he is there. That's why he's there. Well done, brother. The Fly, I mean, the integration of the brand and the Pat and his belief in it, especially it's still there, but those early years when we were talking and you call him or he calls from the car, the integration of the Fly into his conversations and just his life is, I think, why Ticketfly is where it's at and everyone's here. And you look around, there's a lot of friends here. People have been doing, not just young kid, a lot of cool people are here. You know, it's the Fly. And that's true on all this stuff, whether it's an agent, a manager, a band. Hootie and a Blowfish. It's a good story. They used to play Wetlands a bunch. People are like, why? How'd those guys sell 25 million records with one album? And here, this is what I was explained to me, and I believe it's probably true. They're such night when they went around on tour when they were still in a van, they're out of like South Carolina. They got signed up to Atlantic, and they were going around, whatever, there's another fucking band, great bar band. Hey, that helps. Great live show, just a bar band. But they used to hang out with the radio guys in each market, Like they go when they were doing promo first record, meeting radio promo people, probably record label, street team reps, college rep, and they would go to hang out with these people and were genuine and being like, let's go to the bar, let's hang out, and hang out to 4 a.m. so that when the album came out and the first single and stuff, that there were so many people who wanted to work for them and see them succeed. And, oh, I hung out with those dudes till 4 a.m., yeah, you know. That's a big reason why I succeeded. And Dreskin the same attached, you know, we believe in, he believed in it, you know, the fly, you know, and I try to do the same with band. That's why when bands come off, they want to, you know, I'm pretty good at doing shots of tequila. That's so, my thing.
We could keep talking about Hootie, but we're tight on time. So
no, sorry
would you that. Mind talking about the Grateful Dead and how Fare Thee Well came to be and how you, what the part you played in that? Or we could keep talking about Hootie if you'd rather. I mean, is there going to be a 50th anniversary Hootie point. Hootie
the Hootie
show?
Point's what, a good point. You know, it helps to be a good dude. You know, maybe that helped me with the Dead guys. I had done shows with each of them. I grew up a fan. Like, I got here because of something that happened to me at a Grateful Dead show. I saw the, you know, it sounds.
Oh, on the side there, there's me and Jason and Jeff White at the Fare Thee Well.
I knew. I tried to get the 40th anniversary. A lot of people don't know that. I don't even say it. And I didn't. And I love the Dead. I grew up doing, I actually, my first thing when I was in college, I went and made a film about them. I couldn't get them to be in my film about the Grateful Dead. I couldn't get them to do an interview. But I was a big fan, and 50th was coming around. And the cool thing is I had, by doing shows with each of them, I had this relationship, particularly with Phil Lesh. And I'm not sure if I didn't have the Capitol Theater and couldn't meet with, and he was playing my venue. And I knew I'd have him one-on-one, kind of like we are, Steiny, eye-to-eye, at the Cap in the basement.
Did you guys all excuse us for a minute?
I was able to get them all on the same page and do something that was the right thing to do for the fan. And no one expected what happened to kind of happen. We didn't. I believed in it. And I knew growing up, I was being a fish as well. We really talk, you know. So, and growing up at Wetlands, the home for that stuff. And I just knew what Trey could do. I just knew he could do it. And I saw the one time Trey had really played Dead music, he didn't like to do it, was in San Francisco at the Warfield. I believe it's April 98. I went to those shows. I traveled and stuff. I knew, and so I knew how good I thought it would be, and just followed the instincts on, like, we should do Chicago, July 4th, the great American band, the middle of the country. It's the last place Jerry played. Fans love it. They can get there. We can take, and I just went with that. Because at first there were a lot of people be like, why not this? Why not that? And why Trey? You know, and there was a lot of noise. You know, a lot. And he just tried to be like, you know, stick, because I knew the only thing people would remember after, and this is a good, is the show and what happened. There's a lot of stuff before, and you just got to work hard to make that part right.
I get that, because if you look at the picture, you can see something's going on with each of our eyes at that moment.
Here's the coolest thing about the photo. If you look up, you guys look good, but if you look at the back, I actually point this out to people. Look at the crowd in the top row, dead set, you know. All
everyone
the way to the top. But you go to Paul McCartney, Bono, Taylor Swift, any show, anywhere, Stones, in the back corners, they're empty seats, always, any show. What was cool about this one, I wish there could be more shows like this. Look at any corner, look at the top row, look at, you don't see one seat empty.
All I see is how stoned I was.
But that led to an energy. Most people, I don't know, man, unless someone was there, that feeling of being at a con, and it was 360. So on behind the stage was the same view. Not once, no one was who had a ticket was not good. And that was a different level of energy going on.
Now you guys had something going on in Chicago. I got to say, as a fan, I went and experienced something I've never seen before. I saw the Dead as a kid and had been through the experience, but I have never seen a city be so welcoming to an event ever. From the second we got in at O'Hare, they're playing Dead music all along the track. You get to the hotel, and they're playing the music.
Bunch of pilots got together. It wasn't just one. They communicated the morning of the first show in Chicago, July 3rd. All the planes landing played Dead music when they landed.
Wow. That was amazing. You know, it was like, and it timed really well. The night before,
landing in Chicago.
The president you know, offered you congratulations too on the 50th anniversary of the Dead as well too.
I mean, Bill Murray came and helped clean up the trash at the end of the show. I mean, that's better than even that happened. He was sweeping. He's like, I want to sweep.
It's amazing, but, though, the sea of humanity getting out of the stadium, well, this massive rush of people that it was any other genre of music, it would have been scary, but everybody was just slowly walking together. Nobody was pushing. Everybody was taking their time. We were all on cloud nine. It was great.
Thank you, Steiny. One thing that helped is I met with the mayor of Chicago a couple days before and was like, if there's a way to help communicate that it'll be, this will, zone defense will go over really well this weekend versus man to man. And guess what? There were two marijuana arrests the whole weekend in the city of Chicago.
Wow.
So they were playing zone defense for security, but not man to man. You know, when shit then goes wrong, we got this guy's, then he gets aggro and someone else. It helped that it wasn't hot. Weather's like, if anyone's doing outdoor shows, the weather is really important. But we had great weather, so people were chill, waiting on lines. The cops were chill. We did one other smart thing. We got the security guys. This was a good one. This is what I'm doing at 2 a.m. came out. I remember the security guys to wear tie-dye shirts. They still had their numbers, so you could identify them. They're official. So when all the security's wearing tie-dyed, that makes a difference. It made a difference. We haven't done that really since. But they all wore that, and the ushers, and the cops were chill. And when the cops are chill, people are chill, if you can't be. And it was like a feedback loop.
And not only were they chill, creating the show was one thing, but being able to let them or get them to let you do the parking lot.
Yeah.
That was a huge part of the experience. And I was fairly sure that we weren't going to see that. But the fact that that existed in a very natural form.
Yeah. The first meeting we had was like this room, and it was Homeland Security, Chicago Police, Mayor's Department, Special Events, Parks Department, you know, FEMA, like crazy, everything you can think of, state. Federal, and literally homemade. But here's one thing: we got lucky. We were fortunate. Our event happened in July of 2015. Paris happened in like a month later. Security at stadiums changed. I mean, some of them had already changed. This show didn't have airport scanners. It was wanding. And it wanted, but it was a little, it's a different, that's back to that tone. Like, we were able to get the cops to play zone defense. Tie-dyed shirts, but a big thing was the, you know, we were able
to get people in.
Yeah, in a way that's different than when you have to go through an airport scanner. I mean, people will socialize and get used to it, but it's a different vibe going to the Dead's 50th, walking through that. I think little things like that matter. Yeah, so we try to address, I'm like, because that event today, also what's going on in the world, I don't think it would have been, you couldn't be that there now. I mean, you can be here, but it was, what's interesting, one story thing is the people who went to Fairly Well who come up to me, and it happens, you know, once a day somewhere, if I'm in an airport and they're like, yo, bro, they don't expect to see me. And they say the same thing every time, 90 plus to, hey, bro, I just want, yo, you did Fairly Well, right? Yeah. Hey man, I just want to say, and they're like stuttering. They didn't have something planned. That was the best weekend like of my life. And can I hug you? They usually ask to hug, and they say it's not because of how the concert was, the music. It was like I was with my friends from high school and camp and caught. We've got a and that was the magic part of it.
We'd be remiss not to mention that. There's a huge bar there when you put something like that together, especially when you have a missing member. But you guys solved the Jerry problem by having Trixie announce the show on social media with a video. If there's no other way of showing that the family supports this, that Jerry Garcia's daughter announcing the show. How fucking genius was that, dude?
That was just 2 a.m. again. I remember that, you know, thing. So it's always, you know, and little thing, they all add up. That was a good one, and she was super cool. Guess what? She know why she did it? She had been to the Capitol Theater. We have Avenida Garcia. She knew what I, you know, that helps. And that's why it's hard when you're young and starting out. It gets easier when you know people. I knew Trixie. Right. She knew me so I could make the call. Hey, this would mean a lot. I don't know if I could have done that as a cold call. Hey, I don't know. I don't know if someone from Live Nation, if Live Nation could have gotten Trixie Garcia to announce it. Maybe not. I don't know. So I... I'm going to use that again. Thanks, Steiny.
Happy to help. I don't know a better place to end than celebrating 50 years of Grateful Dead and a janitor bill from Bill Murray. That's incredible.
Ladies and gentlemen, give a big hand for Peter Shapiro.
Keep it going for Shapiro.
It's Barry Dickens from ITB, and I'm on Promoter 101.
Dan, we got to jump into some tweets of the week from the past week and explain what was going on in your head when you wrote each of these Promoter 101 tweets. Let's start here. When someone compares their dive bar to the 930 in front of Seth Hurwitz, hashtag dumb Promoter 101.
You can only roll your eyes so far on the back of your head. Holy shit.
The manager of the act is basically an elementary school principal, and you don't want to get called into his office. Hashtag Promoter 101.
Yeah, this is basically the rule in everything in life and industry. The key is just staying out of trouble. Shit.
And how about this one, the third one, last one of the week, when we're way past the media deadlines in a show and being told the manager cannot be reached, but you see how he is currently posting on Facebook.
Busted, motherfucker. Do your job so I can do mine.
And that'll do it for Promoter 101 Tweets of the Week. You can follow Dan on Twitter at The Jew. If you have your own favorite Promoter 101 thoughts, feel free to tweet them at us or email them over. Anything that makes us smile is going to get used on the air.
Harvey fucking Leeds here. You're on Promoter 101, and everything that you've heard in the past are lies and bullshit. Now you're going to hear the truth.
Got some birthdays to celebrate this week, January 19th through the 25th, 2018.
Friday, January 19th, Zach Winston and Baron Ruth.
On Saturday, wishing a happy birthday to CAA managing partner and head of music, Rob Light and Mark Bauer.
Sunday, Tom Taylor.
On Monday, wishing a happy birthday to Aaron Palmer, Universal Attractions, Jeff Allen, and Scott Law.
Tuesday, Evan Kidd Bagart and Kathy Felling.
On Wednesday, happy birthday to Bill Young Productions' Sid Farbstein.
Thursday, American artist Mike Weinstein. We got to love that guy, Mikey.
Wishing all these folks and our listeners a happy birthday from the gang at Promoter 101.
This is Andrea Johnson from ICM Partners, and you're listening to Promoter 101.
If you want to reach out to us, send us an email to steiny@promoter101.net.
We've got a Promoter 101 quote of the week. For those of you West Wing fans, this one comes to us from Leo McGarry. I'm a wartime consigliere too, Toby. I was just hoping it'd be peacetime a little longer. That's to John Spencer and written, of course, by Aaron Sorkin. What a great line.
We'll be back next week with an all-new episode of Promoter 101. That'll be episode 67, a new show featuring Lava's Jason Flom and APA's Andy Summers.
Until then, we wish you sold-out shows for the weeks to come. Cheers.
This is Joe Escalante from The Vandals, and you're listening to Promoter 101.